I head brand strategy and digital media marketing for Nokia Mobiles in India. I'm a consumer tech marketer with 14 years of work experience across some of the most loved and iconic consumer technology brands, which is Nokia, Airtel, and Flipkart. I have done a lot of consumer first category creation work, and I'm extremely proud of the fact that I have been able to get millions of Indians to embrace the digital life. Two things leap out at me when I look at my career journey. The first is that I have spent an equal amount of time being part of a well-structured organization, which was Airtel, and being part of a startup ecosystem, which was three organizations, Flipkart, U-Mobiles, which was a startup by the Micromax Group, and Nokia Mobiles, which is now an HMD by HMD, which is a Finnish startup. And there are very different skill sets that I developed because I was part of these two very different environments. When you are part of a very structured organization, very early on in your career, you develop the skill to think strategically in a very structured manner. You develop the skill of how to communicate across levels. You develop the skill of navigating your way through hierarchy. You develop an appreciation and regard for processes and systems. And those are extremely critical as you go on later to lead some of the companies and some of the categories where you are expected to now set up those systems. Equally, when you are part of a startup ecosystem, there's a completely different muscle at play. You need to know how do you continuously move forward in the even when there is a lot of chaos and there is a lot of ambiguity, which is characteristics of any startup organization. You need to know how do you get stellar ideas and make up what you don't have is actually very, very less resources. So how do you make up for the frugality of resources by over-indexing on ideas and by developing differentiated and market-winning propositions? You also learn how do you develop hypotheses on the go, test them on the go, and then really improvise and just keep moving ahead. So that's a very different skill set, but I think it's the combine of both structured thinking, strategy, and a high bias for action that when they come together, that I think is a very lethal combination. And I'm very fortunate that my career journey has been such that I've been able to fuse the two together. The second thing that leaps out at me when I look at my journey and compare my journey with some of my peers is that I was born into these action-oriented industries. Whether I talk about telecom, which was the sunrise sector back in 2007 when I joined, or I talk about e-commerce, or I talk about the mobile phone categories. Very hyper activity, high competitiveness, always, always buzzing, many, many new launches, many, many new categories or offerings getting launched, new product launches. The mobile phone category has about 70 to 80 new launches in a year. Our company alone has some 10 to 12 smartphone launches in a year and about 5 to 6 feature phone launches in a year. So when you are working on launch one after the other, trying to do new things, trying to find out what is new to the category, what is new to your company, what is new to your brand, there's a lot of learning that is happening, and that learning is happening by doing rather than by thinking. And that's the beauty of it. And what has really happened, because I was part of these industries, because that's the only way I know it there is to work, I have a very strong bias for action. So some of my colleagues who come from more matured industries actually are very flabbergasted. They're like, "Yahan pe to kaam hi nahi rukta. You just keep going from one to another, like what's happening?" But because I was born into these industries and because I started my career with these industries, I think that's the piece of life that I have known. And that's what turbocharges me. So I'm really happy when there is a lot to do. There are a lot of new launches coming up. There are a lot of meetings happening with different agency partners. There's a lot of consumer work happening. That really just supercharges me. And that's what really puts a smile on my face and energizes me really well. I think COVID-19 is that black swan event that has accelerated India's transition into the digital world. Let me explain what I'm trying to say by using some numbers. We are a country of 1.3 billion Indians. out of which 743 million today are digitally available. There is another stat which says that 90% of the traffic that originates on internet today is through a mobile phone. But there are only 450 million people who have smartphones in India. The rest 550 million are on feature phones, which means that some of them who are digitally active are fringe users. But for the first time, we have seen a very sharp decline in the feature phone sales, as much as 68% decline in feature phone sales, which basically means that because of COVID-19 and because so much of our lives are now active digitally, are on digital, are playing out digitally, a lot more people who were fence sitters, who were just waiting to make that transition, have finally transitioning to a smartphone life. If you look at and read reports about the recently concluded sale events by both Flipkart and Amazon, they state that between 65 to 90% of traffic was either by new users or by people from tier 3 cities and below. So what happened till now is that the digital economy was a largely consumption-based economy, and that was driven by the three M's. The three M's are men, metro, and millennials, and they were actually propelling the country forward when it comes to digital. But now, the REW are going online, and when I say REW, I mean rural, women, and elderly. So they will first become a consumption economy, which basically means consuming a lot of free internet, consuming, let's say, free video streaming, free audio streaming, social networking sites, etc. And then slowly and gradually, we will become a transacting economy, a digitally transacting economy. So we've already seen that the number of the digital payments have gone up during COVID-19. E-commerce players are saying that the number of people who are actually shopping, 90% of them are new, coming from smaller towns. So there are these shifts which are happening, and COVID-19 has accelerated this shift. The other key point about India is that unlike the Western countries, which went digital through a desktop or a laptop, we are going to go digital through a mobile. And for marketeers, irrespective of the category that you are, the fact that somebody is on digital and using digital through a mobile has huge ramifications on your marketing strategy, on your communication strategy, on your media strategy. And the sooner we learn and adapt to these changes and to these shifts in consumer behavior, the better equipped we will be to sort of leverage these trends. When I look at digital, I don't think digital is a competence or a skill that one team or one function needs to have in an organization. Digital is now a mindset, it's an orientation, and businesses need to be digital first because the consumer is digital first. And if you leave out that skill set to be part of your marketing team, or if you carve out a team which is a digital transformation team which is supposed to herald that agenda of digital transformation, you will lose out. Because the entire organization needs to have a digital first mindset. It is just not digital marketing. It's about serving the consumer where the consumer is, in a way that delights the consumer. It includes creating experiences which are delightful. It includes creating conversations which are meaningful and engaging. It also means serving the customer in a way that delights him or her. So the businesses need to develop those competencies, they need to develop those technologies, and they need to go digital like yesterday. Even if you look at traditional categories like the grocery category, that had anywhere between 1 to 3% of their business contribution coming from the e-commerce channels, now post-COVID that has in the short run gone up to 5%. And that's only because they were not ready and the ecosystem was not ready, and they're now building that muscle really, really fast. But the future is e-commerce. The future is a digital world. The consumer is seamlessly moving between digital and offline touch points. Marketing needs to be far more integrated. the consumer might see your poster, let's say in a retail outlet, and then go and buy on e-commerce, or he may see your search ad on online and then might end up buying in the store. How do you build an integrated view of the consumer? How do you build a seamless consumer journey? How do you collect the right data and then harness and mine that data to build the right insights? I mean, those are the things that's going to be very challenging, very exciting. It's an evolving field, but marketers who jump onto this bandwagon faster, quickly, will have huge gains to reap in the future. So being a woman team leader, I think there are certain things that all good bosses should do irrespective of gender. So all good bosses need to trust their teams, need to invest in their growth and learning, need to invest in coaching and mentoring them, need to give them space to perform. But as women, we have slightly different challenges. For a lot of women, empathy comes very naturally because from a very early stage, we are conditioned to be agreeable, to be likable, to be the provider. Assertiveness is something that we need to work on because a lot of us are not very tough or don't come across as very tough. And successful women managers actually know how to bridge that gap and balance out their EQ with their task quotient. You know, TQ is how I call it, because it's the combine of the two that is important. And I'll tell you, it's extremely important that as a woman leader, you do not come across as either a pushover and too soft or completely nasty. You need to strike that right balance, and it's important that your team looks up to you as somebody who's tough, who challenges them enough, but equally who's also strong enough to fight their battles when that time arises. All organizations have finite resources, right? And as you keep going up, there are only those many senior level positions which are out there. There are only so many financial rewards that can go out. There are only so many high visibility projects that can be handed over. Are you able to represent your team well? Are you able to highlight their contributions? Are you able to fight it out if the need be to get them their due? That is important. Your team will not respect you if you cannot get them what they truly deserve. And therefore, you need to position yourself as somebody who's tough enough, who's strong enough, and who is persistent enough to get them what they want if they rightly deserve it. So it's important to balance empathy with assertiveness. It's important to come across as being absolutely tough on your team, but also by their side when they need you the most. Note to the next generation of women leaders. I think I will tell them that competence and hard work are highly overrated. Don't get me wrong, they are important for success, but they are not sufficient for success. And a lot of us make the mistake that if we work hard enough, and if we are competent enough, we will succeed both in the short run and in the long run. I feel differently, and that's what I have learned by being in this corporate world for all these years. I think there are five factors that contribute to success. Hard work, no brainer. Competence, we all know. Third is luck. And luck is something that cannot be controlled. It's outside our control. But reflect on your own journey and on your own experiences, both personal and professional. And think of times when you just got lucky and got something that maybe you didn't expect or didn't deserve. Equally, times when you absolutely deserved something and you didn't get it because some other forces were at play. So luck is an important factor. I don't know how to synthesize luck. If you know, please let me know. But it's important to recognize that sometimes we may do everything right and yet something may not fall into place because there are certain other forces which are outside our control which are at play. The two factors in addition to these three which I think we can control and which are a huge determinant of success after mid-career and beyond is, one, leveraging social capital. When I say leveraging social capital, I mean how are you able to build winning personal connections in the professional world that put you up for success. As women, forming connections, forming bonds is something that comes to many of us naturally. But where we falter is that we don't leverage those bonds that we have built for personal success. And that is very important. Men do it all the time. Men do it really well, but we shy away from doing it for some reason. It's important that you enlist allies from day one. It's important that you invest time and energy in finding a sponsor and in finding a mentor in the company or in your field of whichever is your field, because those are really critical to your success beyond a certain level in life. The third thing which is important is also self-promotion. Women just don't want to talk about their contributions. They just don't want to talk about their achievements. They think people will notice them. They think people will recognize on their own. It does not happen. You need to talk about your contribution. You need to talk about what value you add. You need to talk about it in first person. Don't say we, don't say the team, don't say we have come up with, don't say the agency has done it, don't say that I, you know, a group of five people did it, it was a team effort. All bull crap. Say I did this in this project. I'm not saying take claim for what you have not done, but please make it clear what you have done. People don't know. Nobody has time to think about what you are doing, how you add value, unless you tell them. And women are really poor at doing it. You know, women are really poor. We consider that to be bragging. Don't consider it to be bragging. Men do it all the time. They do it over smoke breaks. They do over coffee table conversations, and they do it in both formal and informal settings. We need to do it more. We need to tell the world what contribution we are building, what contribution we are bringing on the table, what battles we are fighting to give that stupendous output, which is giving huge results. Talk about it. Do a little bit of chest thumping. It will take you a long way. It is absolutely critical to do.